Today's reading is from the essence of Ripugita. Ripugita is the song of the sage Ripu. The universe was neither born, nor maintained, nor dissolved. This is the plain truth. The basic screen of pure being, awareness, stillness, devoid of all moving shadow pictures of name and form of the universe, is the sole eternal existence. Some may argue that this universe of duality or multiple existences is a factual reality, clearly seen by the senses, operated by the mind. But then, are the senses anything apart from the mind? Can they function without the support of the mind in which they are embedded? What is this mind, except a bundle of thoughts? What are thoughts, except evanescent ripples in the still, limitless ocean of pure being, awareness, self, which is the sole existence without a second? The existence of the illusion of silver in mother of pearl is not a reality apart from the reality of mother of pearl, which is the basic reality. The illusion of the universe is based on the mind, which again is an illusion based on the still awareness being stillness. In the unitary, undifferentiated, still ocean of being, awareness, self, body, senses, mind, intellect, and embodied souls are nothing but evanescent ripples, not apart from that soul existence. The universe of name and form, the embodied creatures and their creator, mind, desire, karma, misery, and everything other than the self are merely thought formations projected by the power of the self on the screen. The state of firm abidance in that thought-free, alert, being, awareness, self constitutes integral perfection, yoga, wisdom, sahaj samadhi, liberation, the state of Shiva, and the state of Atman self, which scriptures proclaim by the title Brahman. There never was a mind, nor any of its countless forms, like worlds, individuals. There isn't the least doubt that all of these are the form of the eternally undifferentiated supreme self. This is the truth. The one who hears this great secret diligently and understands completely abides as the self. All that appears, appears in stillness, a deep pool of silence, giving birth to infinite variety. Awakening is the return of stillness into itself. Silence, the sound of infinite birth. That you are. to satsang. So in some ways we can say that, you know, meditation and satsang in some way are no more than just returning to this natural stillness. Sometimes when I talk or we read in books about the nature of mind and the nature of existence and all of this stuff, it can all seem very complicated. But in fact, it's not. And what we do when we come together here, and what we do when we sit quietly, whether it's in nature or on our cushion, or we practice any of the silent, more contemplative practices like yoga or qigong or any of these kinds of practices, what we really do is we take a few moments to sort of return to our natural stillness. And of course, most of the time, we don't realize that our nature is stillness, do we? Because we're caught up in the experiences of the body and the mind and the world. And we come to believe that this is who I am. I'm this body. And satsang is really the return to the stillness, which is here before we identify with the forms that appear in the mind. And as Rupu says, you know, the world and the body is nothing more than the manifestation of mind. This is also a basic tenet in Zen. So some of you are from that tradition, you know something about. The notion that we live in a mind-created space. In Vedanta, Advaita, they go a little bit further. The sages will go a little bit further and say that this stillness, this emptiness which we experience, is really our nature. And everything else, while found in that nature, is an extension of it. And so, everything we see then is myself. And of course, this is the reason why we can use the experiences that we're having, whether they happen to be mental states or they happen to be emotional states, or something is going on in the physical body, or we're having some experiences in the world. We can use these experiences as a way to remind us, just by noticing that something is here on the screen, can be a reminder, like a bell in a Buddhist temple, or in an Indian temple. Can be like a mindfulness bell on a retreat, where we simply return to the here and now. And that as we do that, we start that journey back into the being, consciousness, bliss of our own stillness. And we land there. A lot of times when I'm talking with you, I was talking with someone this morning, and I reminded her that what we're really doing in some ways is that we're always just returning our perception to that primal perception that we exist. And so when we're caught up in something, in mind, in body, in world, our practice becomes just the return to the stillness, which is before everything else. And by extension, it's important for us to remember that everything that we perceive is a manifestation of mind. This is why in Vedanta we say, that the world, thoughts, and the body are all illusory is because they can be seen when you return to your basic stillness, to your basic goodness, your basic beingness, your basic lovingness, put that any way you'd like to put it. When you return to what is here in the silence of your own being, it can be clearly seen that everything you're experiencing is an outward flow from that, or you could say is manifesting in that. It can be seen very clearly that everything is still, present. And everything that appears to be moving is something which is manifesting in that. Or as Ripu says and Ramana says, you've heard me say this before, it's just this, a vision on the screen, a movie on the screen of your own being. So this is just a little bit different way of stating it. Ripu speaks in this passage a lot about the stillness of being. And so he's pointing us to something that we, a way we can in fact know that we are approaching ourselves as being, consciousness, and bliss, is that what comes over us is that sense of stillness. And of course, some of you are able to experience that very directly and very quickly for yourselves. And when you come in here, you sit down, it's just a minute, you sink right into that stillness. You're happy to let go of the world and just come into this refuge and be here for a period of time and not think about what's going on in your life or the world. And after a while, if you do this enough, this becomes a regular way of being for you. It's not even a practice anymore, right? It's just a way of being. And you find yourself in the world, and you can just be in the world. And nothing sticks to you. You're like Teflon. As rapidly as things come, you let them go. As rapidly as they try to stick to you, you just let them go. And over time, you learn that by doing this, you remain in your own presence and your own happiness. So one of the things that comes up and came up this morning is there's this question about, but isn't it necessary to understand what's going on in the mind, or to explore what's happening in the mind, or to know why it's here, why a certain experience or a certain set of thoughts or a certain, why is this here? You know, this question comes up a lot for us as humans. And the answer to that is no. It's not necessary. Your stillness and your freedom is your own. You have to own it in the same way in which you previously have owned your thoughts, emotions, feelings, and experiences as your own, and then thought that was the limit of who you were. So you know how to do this. And it becomes only a matter of changing your perception so that the things that you do naturally, putting things down, letting things go, that this becomes your habit, your way of being, rather than the way that it's been previous to that, which is your habit to cling and hold on and wonder and tell yourself that you absolutely need to understand, and you have to understand with your mind that this is the measure of your success as a human, is to understand something about this life. And it's a paradox, because what we really come to understand is that the less we need to understand, the more we actually do understand, because true understanding is is found in the natural silence of your own being. And this is always available to you. Once you know how to put down what's happening in the mind, put down the identification, I am the body, and just remain as you are, being, consciousness, and bliss. Now you can enjoy whatever comes your way. Even if it's difficult, you're not so caught up in it, so you find some enjoyment in that freedom and in that release from the turmoil of your own mind. So just remember, when things are difficult for you, or you've gotten caught in some story that's come out of your past, that what's always needed in any given moment is just to alter your perception. Move attention from whatever it is you feel you're caught up in, or you're experiencing yourself to be caught up in, whether it be a thought or an emotion or an experience, and turn that perceptive ability of the mind toward the question, who am I? Or who is this I who thinks that she is caught up in this? Or thinks that she is disturbed? Who is this I? And of course, this is just a flexion point, you can say, right? This is just what we use to begin to pull our sense of perception away from something that just needs to be let go of and turn it toward something which is real, which is the presence I am. Because in all of the great traditions, perception is everything. So we don't work to change circumstances, although we can, but we don't need to. We don't need to change another person. We don't even, in many ways, we don't even need to change what we think. Because thinking is passing, right? We all know that what we thought yesterday is not what we think today, in this moment. We all know that whatever thought's in the mind right now, it's not going to be the thought which is in the mind tomorrow. And yet we give it such great importance, don't we? We value it, some of us, above all else. In doing so, we completely overlook this turning toward the perception that I am. That my existence is whole and free in this moment and in every moment, in which I'm not distracted by a misperception. Almost everyone that I spend time with, whether it's in satsang or it's in a private satsang meeting, this is what we're always doing. Is you all come in with some turmoil, some upset, some story going on that you've just completely sunk into. And often I only need to say, well, let's change that perception. And it always astounds me how tenaciously you're hanging on to whatever your story is when you walk in the door, and how quickly when I say, well, let's just drop that, you will just drop it. So in many ways, I'm just modeling for you what you will eventually do for yourself. Until you become capable and able to just remain as this still, silent awareness. That which you are by nature. And conditioning has led you to overlook more often than not. The reason I'm saying this today is because I've had a few meetings this week with people who know these things and have yet gotten caught up in something that's been happening with them. And so, to get caught up in some storyline or some past belief about who you are or what your experience is or whatever, doesn't separate you. From the universe in which you live, if you don't overvalue it, so your thoughts can come and go, your experiences can come and go. If where you place your value is on the stillness of your own being, which you experience when you are able to come somewhere or in your own home or whatever, and you're able to just quiet down and settle down for a little bit, you're able to experience the stillness of your own being, just for a moment. For some of you, it's when you go out in nature, or you go on a hike, or you get away from town, or whatever it is. You might have circumstances which you feel are more conducive to your experience of yourself as being consciousness bliss. Again, that's another story. Once you settle deeply into being consciousness bliss, you'll understand that you are that under all circumstances. In the middle of a big city, in the middle of a great turmoil in your life, in the middle of a health crisis, or out in the wilderness. The foundation for all of those experiences is the stillness of your own being. And eventually you'll come there, and you'll feel that restfulness, and you'll feel the gratitude that comes with being released from your own thoughts, and then you'll want to come back there over and over. So the more you do this, the more you support yourself in remaining still, even when the mind is thinking, remaining still even when you're busy in your day, remaining still even when there seems to be a crisis in your body. So today I'm just encouraging you to keep remembering that your freedom is just a switch of a perception away. At any time, in any moment, that you're willing to drop whatever it is you think your trouble is, your problem is, your difficulty is at the moment. By drop it, I don't mean that you push it away. I mean that you don't take it personally. You just allow it to be what it is. And you remain as you are. As stillness. And being. Then your life begins to look entirely different to you. And it is entirely different. It seems to almost take on a new form, but it's not a new form. It's what was there already. I keep saying this to you because I want to keep reminding you that even when you get caught up in difficulty, the foundation of who you are is this being consciousness. Even when you don't feel very blissful. So I keep encouraging you to come back to that. To know that you are not disturbed by what disturbs your mind. You are not your mind. There is no disturbance for you when there's disturbance or difficulty in the body. You are not your body. There's no disturbance for you when you look out into the world and see the difficulties that are here. Difficulties have always been here in this world, haven't they? They probably always will be. The those are not your difficulties. By being here, you've already declared to your life that you are freeing yourself. So just stay with it. Until all the ways in which you bind yourself and trap yourself and so on, all those habit patterns dissolve. Whether it takes a short time for you or a long time. I was talking with someone about the challenges that a person such as yourself faces in this life, because I know every one of you to a certain degree, and I know that you've tried throughout your life, sometimes when it's become very frustrating, to live in a way and in a world in which you contribute to the love and kindness, the awakening, if you will, of the world and those around you. Every person in this room has lived a life that's dedicated to that in some way. But along with that kind of a life desire can also come a lot of frustration. The reason that there's frustration associated with living a conscious life is because there's an expectation that you will see the results of that conscious living, that conscious being, soon. Or certainly in this lifetime. That isn't always the case, is it? For some of us it is. We can see the changes that happen around us. But for others, it's a matter of staying present in moment-to-moment awareness, making small little changes, keeping the heart open in the face of difficulty, remaining loving when it's hard to remain loving, to live a life of kindness, of acceptance, and so on. But without the expectation that you will succeed, or that the change you wish to be and you wish to see in the world will happen in your lifetime. But I encourage you to just keep going. Live the way you know is true to yourself. Contribute what you can. If you're fortunate, you'll live a life of great beauty and love, and that's the way that your life will go. But the world may not change to suit you. So drop the one who needs that change and be the one who just lives the change without expectation, without the need for the world to conform to even your expectations that it will be a place of goodness. All of that is a distraction. Keeps you looking out instead of asking this very important question: who is this I? And coming to know, who is that one? One of my friends sent me a message this week known each other for many years, lived for many years just down the street from each other in Tiruvannamalai. And she's now gone home for the last couple of years. And she wrote this little note about this walking through some forest near her home. And coming around a bend in the trail and seeing a man who was just very quietly walking along the trail, and he was picking up all the trash along the trail as he went. Not that there was a lot of it, but whenever he saw some, he would just stop and pick it up, stuff it in his pocket, and go on. And after some time, she came to a place, and he was sitting on a bench. And so she went over and sat down next to him. She didn't say anything, and he just sat there silently. They sat there silently for some time. And when she looked over at him, she noticed that there was just a gleam in his eye, like she often experienced when she was in India with various sages. And this was a Western man in a Western country. So she struck up a conversation, and she didn't say much about that, but she just went on to relate that he was 101 years old, that he came each day, whenever he had the time, out to this stretch of forest in this park, just to quietly pick up the trash and take it out and dump it somewhere so other people wouldn't see it. He never introduced himself. She didn't introduce herself. He just told her this story, that was his day, and that was what he did to serve the world as he lived in it. And he said that no one ever noticed him, but it didn't matter. He just kept picking up the trash every day. And she realized at a certain point that this was someone who was very, very clear, without any fanfare, about his place and his way in the world and the life that he was living. And she said they just sat there on the bench for a while next to each other. And then after a little bit, she realized that they had both just leaned into each other, and they were there sitting silently with their eyes closed. And after a few minutes, he got up and walked away, left the park. This can be the life that you can have when you know yourself. Yes. If others are around, this is a beautiful thing. If no one is around, you do what you do. You live according to your own truth. Because we don't know what the impact. You know, this being, this man, was there picking up the trash every day. But the goodness and the kindness that he's spreading through that park every day, just through his presence, may be affecting dozens or hundreds of people every day who go through that park. So be like this. In your own way. Find a way to live in a way that is true for you, whether it leads you somewhere or not. To do this, you have to live without expectation, and you have to be willing to allow things to be just the way they are. All of you here can do this. Anything they'd like to share?
Do you personally find it easier to be quieter in India, because India in some ways may be so much more evolved than in the States, and we're so chatty and jabber?
And it's much quieter here.
With people talking?
Well, people talk everywhere. But just in terms of the overall environment and so on, it's much quieter here. The difference might be that when I first went to India, at least my first year was spent getting over my aversion to people and noise and traffic and dogs and cows. Cars that horn all the time as they pass each other, and buses, and smells and sights. Because the sages and the people who live a very spiritual life in India, and even ordinary people, grow up in that culture, which is a very devotionally oriented culture. Meditation is taught from a very young age for many, many people. And that's just the environment they grow up in. It's very noisy, very busy. And so people learn to remain as they are in the center of their own being in the face of the crush of population and the activity of daily life among 1.4 billion people. When we as Westerners go there, it's not in our way of being. We depend on, and one can say, we depend on the externals being in a certain position in order for us to be able to feel our own silence. Indian people really don't need that. They're surrounded by temples and opportunities and sacred places that they visit and go on pilgrimage. They're taught meditation, chanting. These things are part of everyday daily life for ordinary people there. People have altars in their home. They do offerings before they go to work in the morning, before the children go to school, with their meals. So it's a much more spiritual culture in that way, but in terms of the externals, no. You have to learn to adjust as a Westerner. And it fortunately happens relatively quickly when you realize what you're being challenged to do is to allow things to remain as they are and for for you to remain as you are in your essential stillness. Yeah. So for me, in some ways, I can say India was an aid for that. And of course, one of the fundamental foundations of Vedanta is that this stillness is what is the foundation for everything, so this stillness is possible everywhere. So then it becomes possible not to be dependent upon external silence or even the presence of temples or chanting or, you know, all of these things are just present in the world as part of the manifestation of Shakti, divine energy. But they are not. There's nothing about who you are in your essential beingness, which is dependent upon anything, which is a part of our experience. And this is what takes some time to develop, you know, for most people. To cultivate this habit of, as I was talking about, of changing your perception to know that everything is the divine. To keep coming back to that until that becomes your foundation. And this is something you can do in the East and the West. So notice what's happening for you now. Is there anything going on when we naturally fall into the space of our own stillness during the period when we're supposed to or we're used to talking? What comes up for you? Notice it, because it may be what blocks you from feeling your own stillness at other times as well. When there's an expectation that things will conform to a certain pattern for you. And then suddenly there's nothing to do and nothing to say and no one to be. Are you able to let your own stillness just unfold naturally? Are you comfortable in the silence of your own being? Relax fully, or are you anticipating what might come next?
Well, your suggestion for all of us last week was to kind of set aside to-do lists and just let things unfold, and that was a good exercise. Because I've lived off to-do lists for so long. So it was interesting. Oh, the monkey mind just kept coming up and trying to bring me out of a different place, but I just didn't write it down and I didn't check it off and I was okay, I still lived through it. But it's a weird sense of safeness if it's written down and you check it off or something. I don't really understand it, but
well, of course there's a usefulness for that, mm-hmm. But for people that are doers and are identified with being the doer, you may have noticed that that list is endless. As often as you check something off, you add something on, or two somethings. And it's not really about whether you make the list or not, it's about whether or not you can allow yourself to enter into your own stillness when the opportunity is there. Because many people say, I don't have this opportunity that you have, you know, to just notice the still nature of my own being because my life is so busy. But also that's a cover, that's a reason not to experience yourself as stillness or being. So it's not really about whether you make the list or not, it's about whether or not you can experience yourself on the deepest level of being, whether there's a to-do list and things that need to be done or not. But it's good, I'm happy that you did that, because that's important, you know, if you come to this place where you can at least not keep such an extensive to-do list, then the possibility that the natural, unborn, undying stillness of your own being can begin to shine through what the activity of the mind is, because understand that the list, the to-do list, is really just the activity of the mind. But it's the activity of the mind which, left unchecked, veils the natural experience of present moment beingness. Yeah. It's beautiful.
It's such an interesting thing how it will continue to keep us in chaos in our mind if we don't come back to that question.
Yes. But this also, remember, is not you. This is just a matter of conditioning. So, you know, we're all raised to keep paying attention to the mind. And, you know, that's how we learn when we're young. And we learn through our educations and our work life and so on to take lists and make lists and do things and get things done and be multitasking and all of that. And it's just through that conditioning that it takes another person or another situation to remind us that we need to take a break from it once in a while. To inquire into what is the true nature of reality. Is it just my list? Am I just the doer? Or is there something else going on here? Yeah, which leads us to this question, who am I or what is I? Yeah. What's meant when I say I? Most of us, right away, as soon as we take up any kind of an activity or practice like this, we begin to notice right away that it's not really very easy for us to just let a moment of silence unfold and just stay in it and see where it goes. You know. Because our conditioning tells us that when there's a free moment, we need to do something with it. This is conditioning. This is not who we are. This is conditioning of the mind by our society and so on. So then we have to do that what we're calling a practice, you know. We have to come back to recognizing that there are gaps between the doingness, and there are gaps in our lives, and there are gaps between experiences, and there are gaps between thoughts. And explore what happens if we just allow ourselves to fall into that natural gap. You know? And if you're really a human doer, instead of a human being, you can really get yourself in the position where you don't see the gaps at all. You just don't experience that you have a moment's rest from the, you know, or a moment's peace from the time you wake up in the morning until you go to sleep at night. And this can feel perfectly fine until it doesn't. And then the question will naturally arise out of your own beingness to just settle into a moment between two thoughts.
I was kind of picturing, if you have a satsang privately with someone, do you go and open one of their cupboards and whatever, how filled it is how filled their mind is? Is that like a mirror for you to find out? Like, does our world, outside world of our home, kind of represent what's going on in our head a lot of times or not?
Is that what's happening for you right
now? I think that's what, when you said there's no space between things, you know, if you
so look at
average person's cupboard.
Look at your own mind. You're an average person, right? Look in your own mind. Is that what you see?
Well, when I walk into your space, everything's in its place and it's so quiet. But if you walk into other people's places, or my place, it'll be things seemingly moving even though they're not. Because there's so much.
So maybe this is true of you. You don't need to ask me what it's like for me. You can say, yeah, this is the way my mind is.
Yeah.
Once you begin to realize that it makes no difference what's in the mind and what's in the space and what's in the world, there's no need to rearrange your life, right? The silence begins to take over on its own. And in that silence, in that natural presence of being, things leave, people leave. And the difference is that where in the past, every time a gap appeared, you filled it. Now when a gap appears, you leave it. So you're not required to put anything else in it. So you don't need to buy anything, you don't need to add a person, you don't need to subtract a person, you don't need to take a job, you don't need to get rid of a job. You're just present, noticing the natural spaces, the natural stillness in your own mind, even when they're very small in the beginning. And if you need to contain or restrain anything, which is the reason I was doing this pointer today, it's just to get yourself to notice that you don't need to fill the gap. That even in a room of 10 or 12 or 15 people, all of us can just let the gap alone. We can all just be here together in each other's presence and let the silence inform us. There isn't a need for these words. There's a greater need for the silence in some way, until it's recognized that the silence is just the natural state. Now it's not greater or lesser, it's just what is. And initially, we experience that as a one thing over and against another, right? Busyness or doingness or mind or thoughts over and against gaps or stillness or silence. That's the way we experience it because we are conditioned toward the duality. Once we allow the gaps to be there, we begin to see that it's actually the space which is there in those gaps, which is the background or the support or the foundation for everything. And we come to just enjoy that foundation or that beingness. And we just don't take up so much interest. And then the things can continue to come in thoughts or in daily life or in activity. They can continue to come. But we're just not so interested in them anymore. Now we're just rooted in the natural silence, which is the support or foundation for all activity. So now we've breached the duality, right? You understand? In the silence, in the stillness, there is fullness. All in the same. It's all of a piece. Where before we were always separating things out and looking at gaps and full spaces and filling the gaps with busyness and trying to get rid of things in the full spaces, and that was our constant activity. Now we're able to just rest as the stillness itself and let whatever it is be here. And when it's not here, we're just quiet. And that's what you all witnessed here today. When everyone is just quiet, willing to be here, everything is fine. There's really no need to fill the space all the time. In fact, if you really fall into the gap, if you fall into the space right now, you can feel yourself more fully. Not your body, not your mind. Feel yourself more fully as silence, stillness, love, compassion. As soon as you stop waiting for something, you begin to experience yourself as you are. you find yourself challenged by the experience of your own stillness, lean into it. Until you are so comfortable, you can't even think about changing anything. There's a line in Ashravakya Gita that says, the sage is so lazy, he can't even blink. If living like that is a source of terror for you, lean into it. Trayambakam yajamahe sugandhim bhushti vardhanam urvarukami vavandinam rityor mukshiya mamritava swaha uva u om sat jung hum om.
Namaste. Thank you.